الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين محمد بن عبد الله النبي الصادق الأمين، وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين، وكل صحبه طيبون طاهرون، وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين، اللهم آمين. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي أولاً بتقوى الله العظيم وطاعته، فإن تقوى الله عز وجل هي رأس الأمر كله، وأحذركم ونفسي أولاً عن مخالفة أمره ونهيه، فإن معصيته عز وجل هي أساس البلاء كله، ونعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له ولياً مرشداً. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت، ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله عز وجل بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله، وكفى بالله وكيلا. ثم أما بعد، يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: فلما وضعتها قالت رب إني وضعتها أنثى والله أعلم بما وضعت وليس الذكر كالأنثى وإني سميتها مريم وإني أعيذها بك وذريتها من الشيطان الرجيم. First of all, Eid Mubarak to everyone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us our good deeds. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make all of our days happy days, inshallah rabbil alameen, full of happiness, inshallah. The ayah which I just recited is from Surah Ali Imran. It talks about the birth of Maryam, the mother of Isa, of Jesus alayhi salam. Her mother, when she was pregnant, she made an oath that إني نظرت لك ما في بطني محرر, that whatever I will give a birth to will be designated to serve the mihrab, to serve the prayer place. And when she gave a birth, she was a girl, Maryam. So she was saying, the ayah says, what it means, and when she gave a birth to her, to Maryam, she said, قالت ربي, she said, oh my Lord, إني وضعتها أنثى. I gave a birth for a female. Now there is a sentence here, all of us three put it between two parentheses, which it is, والله أعلم ما وضعت, and Allah knows what she gave. And then the ayah continues, وليس الذكر كالأنثى, and the male is not like the female. In terms of what? Serving the place, the worshiping place at that time used to be designated to males. No woman was allowed to serve in the worshiping place. And continued, وإني سميتها مريم, and I called her مريم, وإني أعيدها بك وذريتها من الشيطان الرجيم, and I am seeking refuge by you and with you regarding her and regarding her offspring, and her offspring was one person, Isa alayhi salam, from the outcasted shaitan. The reason why I wrote this ayah is because it's related to my topic today. And my topic is, in general, some misunderstandings about the status of women in Islam. And actually, in general, there are many concepts in Islam have been misunderstood, and distortion happened at different aspects. One distortion says that Islam spreads by sword. This is not right. Rasulullah spent 13 years in Mecca. calling people using just the word, word of mouth. No force at all. The sword was used as later stage to complement foreign policy Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam followed, which is universal. Every nation, every state uses diplomacy and uses material force to complement the diplomacy. It was not used to convert people to Islam. It was not used to force people to accept Islam at all. So when you say Islam spread by sword, in what sense? In no sense. Now there's another distortion, like we said, about women, saying Islam oppressed women. Astaghfirullah. And they bring us one example regarding the inheritance. Look, Islam gave woman half of what gave what was given to man. Females get 50% of what males get. So we need to investigate this. Is it true? Is it true that males always get double the females? First of all, inheritance was always problematic. Before Islam, stepmothers used to be inherited rather than inheriting. If her husband dies, the elder son used to inherit his stepmother like any other piece of furniture at home. He can sell her, he can do whatever he wants. He can even get married from her, astaghfirullah. That was in the Jahiliyyah, that was something Islam faced and changed, of course. And in Judaism, woman is not allowed to inherit any kind of property at all. Islam introduced a comprehensive system of inheritance. I cannot explain all of it in one lecture. It's a course, a college course given in Sharia colleges for 4 months, 3 days a week, 3 classes a week for full 4 months, then you can cover the inheritance. So I'm not going to talk about the details of the inheritance, but I would say this system is more sophisticated and more complicated than saying, well, woman always gets half of man's share. That's not true. I will list 5 points in this regard. If we examine the cases of the inheritance, we can find out that there are cases which are just 4 cases in which women receive half of the share man can receive. Like as an example, brothers and sisters, if their father or their mother dies, then you distribute it 2 to 1. But you cannot generalize it. There are other cases in which woman receives equal to man, which are almost 30 cases. As an example, the parents receive each one of them 1/6 of the inheritance if their son dies and he has children or she has children. So each parent gets 1/6 equal. It's not that 1/3 for the father and 1/6 for the mother to say that he gets double. In the third cases, you have almost 10 cases in which male, females are receiving more than male. And I will give you just one simple scenario. A person dies with lot of children and wife. So since he has children, his wife will receive 1/8. That's we know. Now the 7 parts, the remaining 7 parts of the inheritance would be divided at the rest. So if there are 10 people, then each one of them will get 1 part of the 7 parts, which is much less than 1/8, which their mother got. So the mother in this case gets more than any one of her children. So we cannot generalize and say that woman's share is this or half of man's share. Again, I'm not talking about all scenarios. just gave very simple scenarios, and they do exist. They are practical scenarios. There are cases in which also, in which woman can receive a share and man cannot receive. As an example, they bring us an example. If a woman dies and leaves behind her husband, two parents, one daughter and one granddaughter. Woman dies, leaving one husband, of course, two parents survive, one daughter and one granddaughter. Another woman dies, leaving very much the same, a husband and two parents and one daughter and one grandson. The grandson does not receive anything in that scenario. In the first scenario, the granddaughter receives. And if we analyze the shares together, we can find out that there are cases in which women receive two-thirds of the inheritance. No male at all, in any case, in any scenario, can receive two-thirds. Some women, in some cases, get two-thirds of the inheritance, more than men. In other cases, the one half is the share of just one case in the case of males, the husband only. In one case, man can receive one half of the inheritance. Four cases in which woman can receive one half of the inheritance. And even when we talk about another case, one sixth, you have three cases for men and five cases for women. I mean, if you look at this system, it's very sophisticated. And you cannot say that this system is favoring males because, oh my God, there are cases in which females can get more than males. You cannot also say that this system favors females because there are cases in which males can get more than females. So what's that? Sibghat Allah. The setup is designed by Allah. That's it. And Allah is the one who created males and females. Allah has no gender bias. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not favoring one gender upon the other. Now some people, unfortunately, bring us a phrase mentioned in the ayah which I said, in which it says, وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُكَ الْأُنْثَى, to show us that males are not like females. This statement is not in the ayah, it's not referred to Allah, but rather it is referred to her mother, to Maryam's mother. It was her statement saying males are not like females or females are not like males. And within what context? Within the context which we was talking about. She made an oath that she would designate her pregnancy, embryo, her fetus, her baby. She doesn't know what is going to be, boy or girl. So she is making an oath that this delivery will be designated for the musalla, for the masjid, for the ma'bad, for the place of worship. And that was in their sharia assigned for men only, males only. So when she found that she gave birth for female, she was saying, what is the dhakaruka al-untha? In that sense, not in the sense of that males are better than females, or of course, or females that are better than males. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the ayah, نَخْلَقْنَاكُمْ ذَكَرًا وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most common from among you, males or females, tribes or people, the most common of you in the sight of Allah is the one who has the more taqwa. So we cannot say males are most noble in the eyes of God. We cannot say females are. We cannot say Arabs. We cannot say blacks. We cannot say whites. We cannot say Persians. We cannot say subcontinent. We cannot say Turkish. We cannot say Kurdish. We cannot say Caucasians. We cannot say Native Americans. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. This is the formula. So we cannot keep quoting this phrase which was said by the mother of Maryam to think that Islam emphasized the notion that men are better. Actually, it doesn't say, it says, a neutral statement. Males are not like females. That's true. Who can say that males and females are the same? They're not the same. They are different cases complementing each other for one mission Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put upon both, not upon one. Without male, the life will not be. Without female, the life will not be. Male and female, the union of male and female bring us the life. So they are different. They are not the same. But none of them is superior to the other. That's the point. We cannot say men are superior and women are inferior. We just say they are different, which is the truth, which is a very universal fact. No one denies that they are different. Now, the equality in this is that both are addressed by the same message and both carry the same responsibility. And since they are different, there are certain rules designated to some men and there are certain rules designated to some women. So when we talk about, as an example, child custody, it's the job of woman, the mother. It's not the job of man. It's not the job of father. And when we talk about the qawama, you know, to look after the affairs of the family, it is the responsibility of man. Now, the abuse of this role caused some people to think negatively about the qawama, because they looked at the qawama as the dictatorship. I am the head of the family, I am the boss of the family. I will act within my family like the boss's rules to act in the mafia. You know, whatever I say, it has to be there. No second thought, no discussion at all. It's either my way or else. This is not a qawama. Qawama bishay ay'tana bih. Qawama means to take care of, to look after. This is a qawama. Abusing it caused people to run away from it. And even women now are calling to change it. Actually, the reason why I chose this subject is that last week in one Muslim country, Indonesia, there was a bill introduced to the parliament changing the inheritance system and saying that we want to have males and females receive equal shares. Which part of the system you want to change? I'm very sure that they didn't get through this complexity of the system. They just look at one common case in which brothers and sisters can receive 2-to-1, you know, and generalize and say, yeah, we want to change. But how are they going to deal with these situations? What are they going to do with all of these complex situations? How are you going to distribute the inheritance? Knowing that, you know, in Jordan, as an example, all Christian churches refer all inheritance cases to Shari'a court to settle the case based on the Sharia. They can't come up with a system that is well balanced and, you know, addresses this issue in a very comprehensive way. And by the way, the lack of knowledge about our system, about our religion, can be a reason for this. You know, the Ottoman state, which was Ottoman Islamic state, with misapplications here and there, they used, when distributing the world, the earth, the inheritance, they used to separate between the land or property and money. Money they used to distribute it 2-to-1 in case of brother and sister. The land they used to distribute it equally. Until now, this is the law in Jordan also, the same thing, because they kept applying the Ottoman law in the family law. Why? What was their argument? Their argument was, look, the land in Islam is again divided into different categories. One land is called Kharaj land. Kharaj land, like the land of Iraq, the land of Syria, the land of Jordan, Palestine, Egypt, which Umar al-Khattab, when they conquered these lands, some people said, we want to distribute it to the warriors as a spoil of war. Then he said, no. The deed of this land will be kept for the treasure of the state. The state owns the deed of the land, people have access to the utility of the land. So they can cultivate it, they can build homes. So you have the title is by the state, the name of the deed or the title of the land is under the state name, under the treasurer, and your name will be added as a user, as a beneficiary. So if I die, the state owns the property. So the state will tell us, okay, wait a minute, we'll give it equal to your inheritance, which is right. Okay, so let's not think that the inheritance system in Islam is reduced to just four cases. It's so many cases, sophisticated, complicated, but it's well defined. Not everyone is very well versed of the mirath. يعني from among the صحابة زيد بن ثابت أعلمكم بفرائض زيد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said to the صحابة the best person who used to know from among your companions in the inheritance was زيد. So and Abu Bakr and Umar used to dispute some case of the inheritance. As an example, the case how can we give the share for a grandfather in some cases. So the Islamic system of the inheritance is very well defined, but you need to study it carefully in order to understand each case. And you cannot memorize all cases. No matter how you want to, there are certain tables tell us how to divide, but at the moment when there is a death, okay, the best thing is not to go online and okay, check how can I distribute this inheritance. You need to go to a person who has knowledge about this. He will study the case, he will ask about all inheritors, all possible inheritors. At times brothers inherit, at times brothers don't. And if an unmarried person dies and he left siblings, the siblings will inherit. If he dies and he leaves children, the siblings don't inherit. So you can't say, well, those are the ones who are going to inherit. You list all relatives, say this, present this to a judge or to a person who is expert on this, and you will sort them out. This can inherit, this cannot inherit. This can inherit in this way, farm, or this can inherit in tahsin, some terminology. So, which I cannot translate, actually. I don't see equivalent word for the tahsin. So the point is, the Islamic system of inheritance is very well defined, but it's not simple, it's not easy. We need to understand before judging a judgment and start thinking that Islam put down women in the inheritance. Another example which maybe needs another discussion is regarding the testimony. It's another well misunderstood case. It's not always that the testimony of two women equals one man. That's not the truth. In some cases it is, in some other cases, man's testimony equals zero. Not acceptable at all. So what can you conclude? Can you conclude that Islam favored women or favored men? We just say, well, this is the system, this is the legal system of Islam, and it's not done by one human being. It is set by God, who has no gender preference, who created both, and who knows what fits the human. He created us, and he provided us with the manual. You don't expect from Samsung to give you a manual for iPhone, or vice versa. So you don't expect from iPhone, from other company, to give you a manual how to use Samsung. Samsung provides its own manuals, Apple provides its own manuals. God provides his own manual because we are created by him. We are not created by Apple, we are not created by Samsung, we are not created by the parliament, we are not created by the Congress, we are not created by the Caliph himself, we are not created by the Prophet himself. We and the Prophet are created by God. So God will provide this manual to the Prophet, and the Prophet will deliver it. And at the end we'll see that this is the best system. You cannot suggest any other system. So we need to keep this in mind while we are discussing, oh, should we change the inheritance system in Islam or not? Nowadays, should we change the share of woman? Can we make it equal to the share of man? Well, do you want to do it? What about in the cases in which woman takes more than man? Do you want to bring it down or what? What about the cases in which woman will inherit and man will not? So you are going to disturb the entire system. And who is going to accept it after that? What authority do I have, or do you have, or do we have to suggest a new system? And then people will accept it. The system of inheritance is presented by God, and we believe in God, we believe in His message, so we accept it. So while we are, alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, living this time, facing challenges every day, we need to realize that the system that is set by God is the system that needs to be followed. And it has no gender preference at all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among those who listen to the truth and follow the truth. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم الحمد لله رب العالمين استغفر الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. حديثي كان عن نظام الإرث في الإسلام بشكل ملخص. البعض يظن أن الإسلام أعطى المرأة أقل من حظ الرجل. الذي ذكرته هو أن نظام الإرث في الإسلام نظام مترابط يحتاج لدراسة. هنالك حالات تأخذ فيها المرأة نصف نصيب الرجل كالإخوة مثلا للذكر مثل حظ الأنثيين، لكن هناك حالات نصيب الرجل والمرأة متساوي مثل نصيب الوالدين لكل منهما السدس إذا مات ابنهما، وهناك حالات نصيب المرأة فيها أكثر من نصيب الرجل. مثلا رجل مات عن زوجة وعشر أولاد، فالزوجة لها الثمن والسبعة ثمان تقسم على عشر أولاد، فكل واحد يأخذ عشر سبع الثمن، سبعة على ثمانين، يعني أقل من الثمن، أقل من الزوجة مثلا. وهناك حالات ترث فيها المرأة مع أنه في حالة مشابهة الرجل لا يرث، مثلاً امرأة توفيت عن زوج ووالدين وبنت وحفيدة، الحفيدة ترث، لكن لو توفيت نفس المرأة عن زوج ووالدين وحفيدة وحفيد آسف وابنة وحفيد، الحفيد لا يرث، الحفيدة ترث والحفيد لا يرث. إذا الموضوع ليس تفضيل الذكر على الأنثى، الموضوع وهذا هو النظام الذي بينه الإسلام. وتكرار القول بأن الله عز وجل قال وليس الذكر كالأنثى، هذه الجملة قالتها والدة مريم، وليست مقولة من الله، وهي مختصة بسبب الحادثة، كانت قد نذرت ما في بطنها محررا للمسجد للمحراب، وفي شريعتهم بني إسرائيل كانت المرأة لا تستطيع أن تخدم في المحراب، فلما رأت أنها وضعتها أنثى قالت وليس الذكر كالأنثى. ولا يعني أن الذكر أفضل من الأنثى أبدا، الآية لا تعني ذلك، ولا الله عز وجل قال لنا مزريف العبارة في سورة الحجرات إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى، يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم، إن أكرمكم ذكورا وإناثا، إن أكرمكم شعوبا وقبائل عند الله وأتقاكم، هذه صبغة الله ومن أحسن من الله صبغة. ولا يجوز أن نلتفت بعض المحاولات كما يجري الآن في تونس من دعوة إلى تغيير النظام الأحوال الشخصية بحجة كما قال للأسف رئيس البلاد، قال لما نتحدث عن الإسلام إحنا ما لنا بالدين، ما لنا بالقرآن، ما لنا بحكاية الدين وما لنا بحكاية القرآن حسب تعبيره، كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا. نحن حياتنا هذا الدين وحياتنا هذا القرآن، ويجب أن نتمسك به إذا أردنا الفوز في هذه الدنيا والنجاة في يوم القيامة. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، وبارك اللهم على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا، اللهم هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا، اللهم هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. عباد الله، قوموا لصلاة الجمعة، يرحمكم الله وأقم الصلاة.